Ready or not, here comes science. They might be giants, here comes science.
Hello, everybody, and welcome. Today, I'm going to be talking about a very interesting aspect of science that I really enjoy. It's something about matter, which is, as we all know, everything. Matter is all things. And plus, it's science, so go science, right? Today, I'm going to be talking about the three states of matter. As you all know, we've got solids, liquids, and gases. Easy enough, right? And there are transitions between each one. For example, if you go from a solid to a liquid, you're melting, like ice. Have a little piece of ice, you go blah, 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 blah. Right? If you go from a liquid to a solid, which is the opposite, that's freezing. If you go from a liquid to a gas, then that's evaporation. If you go from gas to a liquid, then it's condensation. Today, I'm actually going to be talking about a very special transition known as sublimation. Now, sublimation is special because it actually skips a step. As most of you know, the middle step in this solid, liquid, and gas is the liquid. So what I'm saying is that we're basically skipping our liquid phase here. Now, the substance that does this that we're going to talk about is dry ice. Ooh. And the reason that it's called dry ice is because if you were to take a chunk of dry ice and just leave it out and just sit there and watch it, or don't watch it, whatever, I don't care, then eventually it would just vanish. Whereas if you were to take a regular ice cube and stick it on there, then it would get all wet and nasty and make a little puddle and blah, right? But we're going to talk about something that doesn't go to a liquid form. Instead, it goes straight to a gas, or rather, it goes straight back to a gas. So, just to demonstrate this real quick, I got some dry ice here. So, this is an example of a little chunk of dry ice. Now, you may notice, first off, that I'm wearing a big glove. The reason that you have to wear a glove with this is because if you don't, then you'll get frostbite. Dry ice is so cold that it'll actually essentially burn you, quote unquote. It's frostbite. It's about negative 109 degrees Fahrenheit, which is right around 79 degrees below zero Celsius for those of you who are in Europe or, you know, normal rather than American. Or at least prefer the normal rating system for everything. Meh. Anyway, dry ice is really, really cold and frequently used for packing foods that are going cross-country, things like fresh fish that's going from the East Coast to the middle of the country, the Midwest, things like that. You use dry ice to package it, and it's also very commonly used in my field of scientific research because we have to send reagents, cells, all kinds of stuff all over the place, and when we do, normally we'll pack it on dry ice because not only is it very cold, but it's very clean because, once again, it doesn't melt. You don't open a box and have a nasty little puddle, a bunch of junk in it. Instead, it's just empty and you got nothing there. So I'm going to do a couple of really cool little things with this. First amongst them is a quarter. This is a regular quarter, American quarter, got our awesome president, Washington, on it. And if we take our little president and stick him into our dry ice, it actually makes it sublimate in a very interesting way. And it also makes a cool noise. So, as the quarters cool and reach the temperature of the dry ice, which is that nice negative 109 degrees, as they reach that temperature, eventually they stop shaking. But as they're going down in temperature, what they're doing is they're moving back and forth really, really quickly. And when they do that, they sublimate the sides of the valley that they make, so it sort of makes a little puff of smoke and goes like, When it does that, the quarters are forced back and forth and back and forth. And it happens so quickly that you can't really see the little puffs of smoke, but you can see the result on the quarter, which is it shaking. And now you can see our quarters are nice and frosted, even after they've been out for a little while. Pretty neat thing. But the thing that dry ice is most famous for is actually when it's added to liquid, specifically just any liquid. In this case, I'm going to be using water, but two different temperatures of water, because we can demonstrate one of the other properties, which is heat transfer. So right here, I have a cup full of water. In this case, this is pretty cold water. And I've got another cup here that I'm going to fill with hot water that just came off the stove. So it's nice and steamy. So we got our two cups, hot, cold. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a piece of dry ice and put it into each one, and we'll watch it sublimate really, really fast in both cases. At room temperature, dry ice sublimates at a relatively steady rate, but when we add it into water, we make it sublimate just a little bit faster, especially if it's our hot water. So you can see here, guess which one's the hot water? That's right, it's this one. Because the hot water causes the ice to sublimate much, much faster. And therefore you get the smoke a lot faster. Ah, that was fun. Science is happening. So if you ever have a Halloween party, now you know. That's how they get smoke in those. And I'll be right back. And we're back. So, now what we're going to do is something very, very similar. I'm going to take a bunch of my nice hot water, but now I'm going to add soap, just regular dish soap. Now when we add this, as you know, water and soap makes bubbles. And water, soap, and dry ice makes better bubbles. In this case. Ooh. Bubbles. So all that's happening is once again our dry ice is sublimating, but instead of the gas leaving as that smoke that we saw earlier, it's leaving as little bubbles. It makes a nice little hat. See that? It's fun. All sorts of fun stuff that you can do with dry ice. Really, really simple. It's really cheap, too. And this is all stuff that you can do at home. I'm at home right now, and I'm playing with dry ice, and it's fun. So, if you ever want to make a bunch of bubbles, or if you just want to wash your hair a little bit, feel free to use dry ice. You'll smell lemony. It's awesome. You can't beat it. And with that, I'll say, I've got bubbles in my face. That's what I'll say. I will say thank you all very much. I hope that you enjoyed my little video on dry ice. And I hope that you learned a little bit something, not only about matter, but a little about sublimation and how it works and what happens. Thank you all again, and I'll see you next time. The majority of carbon dioxide that we exhale comes from these two processes, glycolysis and the citric acid cycle. At the end of glycolysis, pyruvate undergoes a transition to acetyl-CoA and carbon dioxide by pyruvate dehydrogenase. The acetyl-CoA then goes into the citric acid cycle, where at steps 3 and 4, additional carbon dioxide is released, which then goes to be exhaled. Carbon dioxide generated from glycolysis and the Krebs cycle in both plants and animals is used by plants to generate new sugars. They take atmospheric CO2 and they use it to create glucose, fructose, and other different sugars. Between the processes of cellular respiration and photosynthesis, we have two of the major components of the carbon cycle involving atmospheric carbon. Photosynthesis and metabolism create a cycle amongst themselves.